Imagine you're at a grocery store. You have a headache, you have a little bit of dizziness, and you feel off balance and nauseous. Once you hang on to the grocery cart, you feel a bit better. You start your shopping, but it takes you way longer than normal because you have difficulty finding items. You check your list on your phone, but the bright light hurts your eyes. Your headache is building. You go to the checkout, and when you go to pay, you can't figure out the bills in your wallet. The cashier is looking annoyed. You tell her, "I'm sorry, I have a concussion, and I can't seem to figure out money." Her face softens, she helps you pay for your groceries, and you head out. When you get into your car, you burst into tears because you realize you still have to drive home, unload and unpack your groceries, make dinner for your family, and take your daughter to practice. I'm a physiotherapist with Parkwood Institute's Outpatient Acquired Brain Injury Program, and what I just described is a pretty common experience for the patients that I work with persistent symptoms after concussion. So I'm going to talk about some of our team's favorite life hacks and treatment strategies that help our patients on their road to recovery. An important principle of neuroplasticity, or changing your brain, is that you have to challenge your brain in order for it to improve. The key to our approach is finding the right level of challenge. So I illustrate this to our patients by drawing a large circle on a piece of paper and say, this circle is your pre-injury life. Work or school, social, exercise, parenting, housework, all the things you do in your rich, full life. Then I draw a much smaller circle inside the big one and say, this is your post-injury, your post-concussion circle. If you stay in this little bubble, your symptoms won't feel so bad, but you won't improve, and it's really not enough of a life. So then I draw a third circle, and this one is slightly larger than the post-concussion circle. We don't want people to do everything the way they've always done them. We want them to work, push into symptoms a little bit, so they're working slightly harder than is comfortable for their brain. As they do this, their brain improves and their tolerance for activity increases. So then their post-concussion circle gets larger, and as it gets larger, they can add more of the right level of challenge into their day. So how do we do this with our patients? We do this through pacing and planning. This means we have people schedule out all the activities of their day ahead of time in order to maximize their energy and productivity and minimize decision-making and their symptoms. We try to use their symptoms as a guide for how much activity they do. We look at how quickly they do a task, their symptoms come up, and we don't want it to go more than 2 out of 10. All this is individual because every patient is different. We also look at how long it takes to settle the symptoms back down again. And we encourage them to do that by either taking a break or switching tasks. And we want things to settle within an hour. We help this by having patients make a list of things and activities they can do to settle their symptoms. We like mindfulness, deep breathing with their eyes covered, cuddling with their pets, or listening tasks like audiobooks, podcasts, or music. Then we take these relieving activities and we put them into the schedule in between the more provoking activities. But life does not end when you have a concussion. So we teach our patients strategies so that they can still do their everyday tasks they need to get done. We teach them, sit down to fold your laundry so you don't get dizzy from bending over. Vacuum the first floor of your house one day, the second floor of your house on a different day. Order your groceries online rather than tackling the grocery store. If you have trouble remembering things and your brain works hard to do that, use your phone or a daytimer to write things down. These small changes can really add up to help people more productive and have less symptoms. When you have symptoms like headache, light, and noise sensitivity, it can be really hard to engage in life because when you leave your home, it is noisy, bright, and overstimulating. Many of our patients become socially isolated. We know it's so important for them to get out and spend time with friends and family, but they have to do it gradually and they need to plan ahead to have it be successful. We want them to take a rest or a break before they go to an event. We teach them to think about the environment and plan ahead. Is it going to be outdoors and sunny? Is there going to be fluorescent lighting? Then bring sunglasses and a hat with a brim. Is it going to be noisy with lots of background music or conversation? Investing in musicians' ear filters or noise-canceling headphones can be a big difference in how long you last at an event and your ability to engage in conversation. Don't sit next to the music speaker. Avoid the uncle with the loud voice and booming laugh. When the small children are downstairs, you head upstairs. At a restaurant, ask them to turn down the music or sit you in a quiet area facing the wall away from the busy restaurant. It's also important to take a break during events, and setting a timer can help you do that. Leaving an event early or arriving late can decrease the amount of time so you leave before symptoms are too bad. Call ahead for the host and ask if there's a quiet room you can take a 20-minute break in or do some mindfulness. My favorite strategy to take a break was taught to me by a patient. He would bring items into his car and park a small distance away at a social event. Then, when he needed to take a break, he would wander out to his car to grab one item at a time. We love when our patients come back to us and say, I used the strategies and it worked. Here's what I want to do next. Everything I've talked about are coping strategies, but you also need to retrain the brain to help recover. There are way too many treatment strategies for me to talk about in a talk this length, but I'm going to talk about a few fundamentals. First is sleep. We know that is critical. You need to go to bed, wake up at the same time, and think of using other sleep hygiene principles. Try a sleep meditation if you have difficulty falling asleep. Exercise. There's a lot of good research that says cardiovascular exercise will take your symptoms down. So we often start patients on a simple walking program. Challenge your brain to handle stimulus. Don't live in a dark and quiet environment. We have patients gradually expose themselves to noise and light, including screens. If you have visual problems, we try something called bi-nasal occlusion, where we take a cloudy piece of scotch tape, put it on the inside of your glasses or on empty lenses, and that can have a dramatic improvement in patients' ability to read and reduce their headaches. Tackle consistent cognitive challenges daily. Plan your menu out. Do your schedule. Pay your bills. Do a puzzle, right? Or memory games. All of that challenges your brain. But most importantly, plan and pace. Write your schedule out ahead of time and try to follow it. Recovery from persistent symptoms after concussion is a marathon, not a sprint. Work on finding the right level of challenge for you, because if it doesn't challenge you, it doesn't change you. Thank you.